doors missing. Classic Dunedin student flats.
Ōtapōti, Dunedin.
That's a fail.
It's a big fail.
Te Whanganuia, Tara Wellington.
So this window here has got tape to hold it together.
Tamaki Makaurau, Auckland.
And it just got worse over time.
For some renters, that home sweet home vibe can quickly turn sour.
We've heard from desperate tenants from all over Aotearoa, but our story starts here in Ōtapōti, Dunedin.
This is Castle Street. Students have lived here for years. But more recently, they've parted here too, and for some flats, that can mean a bad hangover.
The owner needs to see this.
Students are paying around $180 a week each for a unit like this. They asked Fairgo to check if it complied with today's healthy home standards. Six sections need a pass.
Drainage and guttering, drafts, moisture barrier, insulation, ventilation, and heating. The heating required is going to be massive for this.
Many older properties are exempt from the insulation and moisture barrier standards because of lack of access. That can make them even harder to keep warm, this one included.
It's an inaccessible floor, it's too low to the ground.
But on three of the other four criteria,
it's a fail.
Too drafty, not enough heating, broken drainage.
Smells like sewage, this is not good. It's definitely not healthy.
The landlords say it did have the tick in April and that student behaviour was to blame. It does seem when partying shifted from bars to the streets in century-old houses, it made for a challenging combo, and it's not just this one.
I've seen worse, to be fair. Ones that are, I personally think they need to be demolished.
Not healthy for the students and a headache for the property managers who tell us they go above and beyond to make things right.
Is it the landlord's responsibility or is it the tenant's responsibility?
I think it's a joint venture. The tenants need to realise it is someone's asset, but yeah, I think the owners need to do the same as well.
And they are. Since this new assessment, they've done further work on the drafts and drainage. And they're planning renovations, hoping to future-proof against party-fueled problems.
It's been like this for years, but I think it does need to change.
But it got us thinking, how many tenants live in unhealthy homes? And are the new standards that became law in 2019 any help? After all, the idea was to make sure all rentals met the minimum standards for health.
We put a call out on Facebook and we got swamped.
A flood of photos and videos from all over the motu. Mould climbing up the walls, water pouring down. Letters from doctors linking living conditions to poor respiratory health. At Dunedin's Citizens Advice Bureau, it's a hot topic.
The healthy home standards are critical. They are the law, so it means they have to be in place.
But lots of tenants wouldn't front about their complaints for fear of getting evicted.
We hear that all the time. That is a real worry.
It's the same story in the Bay of Plenty. We're going to meet an advocacy group for tenants who see firsthand what can happen when complaints are made.
I've had experience of tenants who have asked for necessary repairs to bring the home up to the minimum standards and they have received eviction notices.
The property owners know that if a tenant complains or asks for help, they can get rid of them and another person will be willing to rent the very next day, regardless of the condition of the home.
Day in, day out, Jo and her team try to help the most vulnerable. She wants to acknowledge most landlords are great and the healthy home standards are useful. But she thinks they don't go far enough and it's too easy for some landlords not to comply.
Anyone can say that the home has reached the standard, whether it has or not. There's no checks and balances on the certification get signed off.
She's helped arrange for us to talk to a mum whose home needed lots of work to be warm and dry. The conditions were making the baby constantly sick.
I think most people probably wouldn't understand or wouldn't believe the state of the homes that we see.
But at the last minute, the mum pulled out. Jo's not surprised. Sometimes they can't get them even to lay a complaint.
They're too scared to ask for repairs or help because that is better than nothing. These are real people. These are people with children and babies and living in properties that are full of mould and you can't open the windows and you can't hang curtains.
In Tamaki Makaurau, Auckland, Harry is braving the camera. She stores her clothes in her bedroom. She can't sleep there because of this.
These buckets have been left out overnight.
10, 12 weeks ago now, I was sleeping, the whole kind of ceiling just ripped open and I got a fright.
There's some water bubbles forming in other parts of the ceiling.
And there's this.
A leak on the side of the bedroom. Our rent at the moment is $730. So we've been paying our rent, you know, consistently. I would confidently say that our agent would say that we're good tenants.
They did get a rent reduction of $50 a week, but Harry says it's not the point.
Like, we want a healthy home.
Leaks aren't part of the healthy home standards, but landlords are responsible for fixing them in a prompt manner as they're a serious issue.
Oh, hi, it's Jill Higgins from Fair Go here.
The property manager explained the delay was too few tradespeople and the weather.
During the June, July and August, all ringing day.
But she adds now they have secured a builder.
Very soon can start.
In Te Whanganui Atara, Wellington, a quick fix would be music to Claire's ears. She lives with her student flatmates.
I would say, honestly, I think we're probably the best tenants that our landlord has ever had. We try and clean the mould off regularly, but it just does come back.
But no amount of cleaning does the trick.
So yeah, we've got some condensation over here.
It's not that surprising.
Whenever it rains, leak.
Moving into this flat was a last resort, but
it was really cheap and we don't have a lot of money.
But they didn't expect so many problems. This cup's full of rusty rainwater that leaked over Claire's bed.
Gave the landlord a 14-day notice and said basically like, hey, in 14 days, can you please get the house up to standards? You need to do this, this, this.
They asked for fixing the leaks, complying with healthy home standards, providing heating and dealing with the rat problem. The landlord says everything has been fixed, but admits no healthy homes assessment has been done.
You know that that's a legal requirement now?
Yes, I realise that. So that's what we were aiming to do in the next month or so, because I've actually been not well of late.
So there's the problem. It's that easy to avoid giving a guarantee of basic health standards. So we wanted to know what those in power thought. After all, if you're renting a car, it's pretty easy to know. So why not a home?
They are effectively voluntary. That's because the government is not collecting any data on the exclusions that landlords are themselves reporting. They also don't know how many homes are actually up to scratch.
The Green Party has been campaigning for a rental warrant of fitness.
Well, there are responsibilities that come with goods and services and being in business in this country. And I think none is more fundamental than housing, which we've recognised as a human right.
We put a question to the Housing Minister, Megan Woods, and she just sent us a statement which said, implementing a WAF would come with significant costs, and as we enter a period of more targeted spending, we don't believe the level of regulatory compliance that could be achieved would justify the additional costs at this time. What do you think of that?
So when we're talking about the costs of implementing this, let's talk about the benefits as well. Let's talk about the fact that more families and more people being able to live in homes that are fit for purpose and that are healthy.
Back in Claire's flat, she says it's clear as day there's still mould and damp. So she says their stuff gets ruined and it's affecting their health.
I do get sick during winter sometimes, but it was just impossible to get healthy again. So that's when we thought we need to take action.
So after less than a year, they're moving out.
Yeah, it's just not ideal to live here.
For the $200 or so they'll each pay every week, they're not expecting fancy, just free of mould and dry.
Part of owning the property is that there's always going to be ongoing costs. And I don't think they're unreasonable costs, because everyone in New Zealand deserves to live in a warm, healthy home.
Hopefully we all agree with that. Now look, we should say though that Claire and her landlord disagree on whether there's been good communication about the ongoing problems with the flat.
Now, in general, if landlords are found guilty at the tribunal for breaching the healthy home standards or guilty of evicting tenants just because they complained, then they can be ordered to pay damages.
That's right, and that could be up around $6,000 to $7,000. Also, tenants can now get name suppression, but it is a lengthy process, and we're told many tenants still feel it's too much risk.